Hey, it's time for the Kita Anime Podcast. In this episode, Deedo and I, we talk about how our show schedule is screwed up because of an anime. We start up a new drinking game, a panty drinking game, and we learn how to do a FALCON KICK! All that and more, coming up. Pon Pon! Time for the Kita Anime Podcast with Deedo and Ktdata. The Kita Anime Podcast is brought to you by Ktdata.net's coverage of CES 2012. Join Ktdata as he explores the show floor of the 2012 CES trade show. Follow Ktdata on Twitter at twitter.com/Ktdata and keep an eye on Ktdata.net for the latest news from CES 2012. And I'm going to go pass out now.
Breathe in, KT, breathe in.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the Kita Anime Podcast. The guy who's catching his breath because he's terribly out of shape is me, Ktdata. And the guy next to me, well, that's Deedo. How are you doing today, Deedo?
Fantastic.
Are you sure you're fantastic? You know, it's the new year and everything, so. You starting anew, or are you just going to be bleh with the day?
I'm idling through.
What?
Yes.
I don't understand. Anyways. Well, at least we're doing something that we always do every year. Well, starting last year, we're watching anime, right? Yeah?
Yep. So I don't think there's anything really new going on this year so far. Same old, same old.
Pretty much. Yeah, so it's same old, but some of you guys probably have not seen this. Why are you watching episode 6? Unless you're watching live, then you're like, what are these two crazy guys doing? But what we do is we grab three animes, you know, two of them ending this episode, so it's kind of our, you know, halfway. But actually, the next episode will be starting our winter season. So I won't say fall anymore on the episodes. It's going to say winter. And there's still no snow outside where we live, which is really weird, and we're going to have a drought. So, but yeah, and warning, we have spoilers abound, right, Deedo? Lots of spoilers.
Very much so, spoilers. We cannot emphasize this enough, yes, that there will be lots of spoilers.
Much, much spoilers. And yeah. So let's just jump into our first episode by doing this. So everything that makes me whole, ima kimi ni sasageyo. And our first anime is Guilty Crown. It's brought to you by Take It a Few Weeks Off. Everybody needs a break, including Guilty Crown. Thanks a lot for screwing up the schedule, Guilty Crown!
Yes, to just elaborate on this itself, Guilty Crown will not have their 12th episode until about the 12th of January, so therefore we only have one episode to cover on this show.
And it's probably a good thing, because we always spend the most time on this anime, out of all the animes we do. And so, guess what? You're not going to hear us go 45 minutes about it because we only got 20 minutes of show to watch. So hopefully we can do it in 10.
Maybe.
Yeah. So, Deedo, how about you tell everybody where we last left off?
All right. Last time we killed the crown, we see the return and breakdown of Yahiro. Jugo's all emo. Things fire up in Tokyo when the tower turns into a giant tuning fork and unleashes the apocalypse virus again.
I was just animating everybody what happened.
Yes, I'm pretty sure all the people who are watching, all this one person who's watching, thoroughly enjoyed that.
I hope so. They probably weren't even watching, to be honest. They're like, eh. Anyways. But, so, this episode, last we left off, this giant sound wave or whatever Guilty Crown equivalent of that is, and people are getting the apocalypse virus and turning crystal, and like we've seen before, including, I can't say it, you know.
Yes, one of our best comic reliefs gets turned to crystal.
Oh, yes, poor Dan. Yes, Dan, of all people.
Sad panda face. Sad panda face.
Oh, Dan. You're the best token white guy we ever saw in an anime.
Oh, yes, yes, he was.
But what it turns out to being is that the, what's his name? I wrote it down somewhere. Kato, he's having the GHQ coup d'etat. And yes, I managed to say some interesting, fancy-sounding words. But yes, he managed to get everybody who was loyal to him, and now he's in control of the entire GHQ army. And he essentially declares even more martial law, that
it's like if they couldn't get any more martial law than that, they have extended it even further.
Yes. And you know, like through this whole time, I was expecting to have Shu's mom, you know, be in on all this and know what's going on and everything, but apparently that's not true. You know, they Kaido is just. Or not Kaido, it was the other guy.
Talking about Scarface?
Yeah, Scarface. Scarface. Yeah,
I don't know his name. We just call him Scarface, because that's what Dan calls him.
Rest in peace, Dan.
We have to commemorate Dan for this. So his name is now Scarface, regardless of what anyone else is.
Yes, because Dan said so. But yeah, he pulled a gun to Yahiro's mom.
Chu.
Yeah, or Chu. Wow. Yeah, Shu's mom, and yeah, the name's written right here too. And Dan, in his last valiant effort as our token white guy in the anime series, dives and gives Shu's mom enough time to run away, but sadly Scarface puts a bullet through his chest. If getting the apocalypse virus wasn't enough, he had to put a bullet through Dan's chest.
But he did do it in the most best way possible. He gave him the Dan Falcon Punch.
Yes. He's like, how dare you put your hands on a woman?
How dare you point a gun at a woman?
Yes, yes. Point a gun at a woman. Yes.
I'll write it in right over here just for you.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, one of these days. But this is the weird thing is apparently we find out the source of the apocalypse virus. And of all the names in the world,
guess what they pick? Of all the unique names in the world you can call something, you know, for being original as a show is...
Like, Apocalypse Virus was a cool name, but can you guess what this name is? It's actually Mana. So,
Originality.
You know? So now apparently Mana is the secret source of apocalypse viruses, or the things that you tap when you're playing Magic the Gathering.
Yeah.
That's scary sounding.
So every single time you play Magic the Gathering, you tap Mana, you are actually causing the apocalypse virus.
That would actually be an interesting way to play Magic the Gathering, though.
Yeah, I'd play more of it.
I crystallize you! crystallize! That turned out the wrong way. But, anyways. let's not forget when that Tuning Fork or Tokyo Tower went off. Oh, I love that. Pretty much the entire Undertaker force was on that military base where it all originated from. And they show scenes where the... one logistics chick, her trailer's totally trashed. They're down to one mecha for the wheelchair girl. And pretty much the regular extras are still alive. but like, you know, those no-name guys that you never see, according to the intel report that we hear in the anime, they're all gone. Wiped out or crystallized or whatever that may be. So, guess who has to go save the day?
I bet you couldn't guess, guys. I really don't think you can guess who comes and saves everybody.
Fear from C3. Oh!
Right!
Random anime crossover!
Yeah! Now we all find out it's Shu. Shu gets all his friends together in an effort to rescue the Undertakers.
In a loving family, because everybody agrees, right? Right off the bat, they're like, sure, grope me all you want. But no. I've always wondered, why in the world did they call this Guilty Crown and not Groping Crown? Because Groping Crown sounds so much cooler. But can you explain this to me, Deedo, why in the world they called it Guilty Crown?
So it's because of Shu. He, every time he grabs a void from somebody, he has this guilty feeling to be grabbing them without their permission. Yeah. I mean, if you think about it, he has every right to feel this way because you're kind of playing with their souls without someone's permission. That would piss off anybody, really.
Yeah, I don't know. I kind of like it. Oh, did I say that out loud? Dang it. But yeah, and then of all the people he has to get, he gets Yahiro and he does the, I hate you, you kill my little brother, I'm gonna beat you to the pulp kind of thing. Like, seriously, I don't know why, but they've made me hate this. As much as I love Dan, I hate Yahiro that much and more because he's a jerk face.
In other words, too, he's also a very shallow character for everyone else who doesn't understand jerk face.
Yes. Like, it's the weirdest thing. You'll see it through this episode. They just mold him into whatever emotion they need him to be at that time. And it's very...
he literally is the cheerleader. You know, that one person sits in the back. He's like that fat cheerleader at a football game, you know, that sits back there and just mimics everybody else, but at the same time, too, not actually in sight. But is mentioned all the time.
Yeah. And then, you know, we finally see more. Inori is still alive, of course, but if you haven't figured this out by now, Guy has the apocalypse virus, and he's starting even to crystallize more. And then they run into Shu's mom, have a little interaction type thing, and like, oh, we're buddies on the same team. So they all run up to the radio tower together. And then Shu...
And I failed to mention that Inori almost kills Shu's mom.
Oh, yeah. She had a gun up to her face.
Knife to her throat.
Yes. She snuck up on her. And then she's like, where's Shu? Where's my son? Is he okay? And then they're like, oh, she's a buddy. And they go up to the radio tower or communications tower, whatever they call it. It has a giant satellite dish on it. And then you see Shu's mom typing away at the keyboards, multiple keyboards, setting something up. And all of a sudden, Inori starts singing. And guess what? That mysterious song that they've been alluding to, it's the counter. What do you... Counter,
the cure, if you mind.
Yeah, counter wave to the apocalypse virus and kind of nullifies the effects of the other one. And like, you see all those people are going like, and turn all crystallized. The crystal just like breaks off on their guy. That happens to him too, except you notice not all the crystals fell off his face, just most of them.
Yeah.
And you know, that's all fine and dandy, and then it I just noticed this episode has a lot going on in it, but really didn't do much, because you know, you see Shu on his little train of buddies all driving along, you know.
You in see, a little buggy.
Yeah, in a buggy. You see all the voids that we've seen before, and plus a new one from, what's her face? Did I write her name down somewhere? No idea.
No, we haven't.
You know, the girl that's been helping her. She, of course,
apparently,
has...
Apparently her void is, like...
The ability to heal.
I want to say it's, like, goggles. You know, basically, it's, like, binocular. She has, like, the ability to just see things from long distance. I don't actually know what the whole term of the void is, but that's all we see. It's like, oh, look, there's Enery all the way across there.
Yeah, there. And they drive towards it, and Shu heals a bridge. You're like, really? Really?
Yeah, because
a bridge you can repair robots.
Seems like Hare's void is how they he like tries to show everyone exactly what his power is. Her void is the heal. You know, like her bandages, her void bandages.
You know what that reminds me of?
It will heal. Let's not. I know what you're thinking about. All I'm pretty sure everybody here knows too.
All right. Okay, judge me all you want. But yeah, I thought it was kind of stupid that they healed a bridge. A bridge? Really? That was kind of stupid.
Hey, it surprised them. That's what they're all like, Sugoi.
Oh, Sugoya. And then...
He could heal a bridge. That makes him so awesome. Anyways.
Yeah. At the end, you see Shu jumping. He like didn't take stairs. He like literally... jumps to the radio tower.
Runs up the freaking wall.
Because that makes sense, totally, since he's, I don't know, has superpowers now? Or he runs up a wall.
He's using the scissors. He's using the death scissors, so therefore it allows him to run up walls like a ninja.
Well, no, it's like in Counter-Strike, you know, when you hold the knife, you run faster.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah. That's how it works. Now it makes sense.
Yes. The mystery of the void has been solved. Hold scissors to run faster.
Yeah. Then Inori has this embrace. He gropes her a little bit. Well, he was going to try and grope her, and then all of a sudden this mysterious purple cloud of haze comes out, and that kid that we always see in the background of some episodes, he pops up, and then he gropes Inori. And pulls out her sword, but it doesn't look like her normal sword. It's like longer and more bleh. And then he totally kidnaps Inori, disappears, which means it stops that wave, and all of a sudden the apocalypse virus starts going again and making the Tower of Sauron in the middle of Tokyo.
Yeah.
And
but just because I want to do this, the kid that gropes an earring, I'm calling them eyebrows.
Eyebrows, yes, yes, like this.
Of like all the things, of all the characters defining, you know, their facial features or anything, the facial features that defines themselves, it's his freaking eyebrows. I mean, those things are so poofy.
Yeah.
I mean, wow. He's forever going to be called eyebrows to me.
Yep. And then, before the episode ends, for no really good reason, guy randomly appears. You see him climbing a set of stairs, struggling, might I add, but he appears at the top of the tower, and then Shu goes and grabs him and is like, this is why I can't leave you in charge, and then collapses.
Well, he was he did take the swipe of the sword from eyebrows, so if you didn't notice that.
No, not really.
Yeah, because just before he leaves with Enery and everything, he does take a swipe at Shu, but Guy took the blow for him, and then the reason why he was bleeding and passes out from, you know, the loss of blood.
Either way, I'm like, really? You couldn't fit another anime cliche into this? But it's okay. We still have 12 more episodes of this.
Yes, still have a lot more to go. So next week, we will be covering 3 episodes of Guilty Crown.
So the show's going to even be 20 more minutes late.
Show's only late this time because I had to go to the bathroom before. That's the main reason why we were late this time.
I told him,
KT is not to blame.
I told him to take the camera with him, but he wouldn't. He's like, I don't have a USB cord long enough.
I don't. I only have 10 feet of USB cord.
But yeah, so that's pretty much all we have of Guilty Crown. So hooray, we actually finished in less than 20 minutes of that. But Guilty Crown, out of the three, I would rank it second highest, or the second of the three of my favorites. Let's go to the number one of the three I liked. The C3 segment is brought to you by...
Get there!
Come on, Deedo.
Ladies and gentlemen, I had just botched this segment.
I spent all the time writing this ad, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's brought to you by Ganon. Take a Ganon camera with you, so you don't miss those important moments in life. Now in HD. Oh, but when we last left off, Fear's still learning how to do the dance to the intro that they changed. Deedo screws up the ad read. We learned about some cursed hair, why violation cases should be illegal in the country of Japan altogether, and why not some SNM? Why not? Oh, I love this anime.
Whether you wanted to or not.
Gotta admit, you love this anime, Deedo.
Funny thing is that C3, from start to finish, we'll explain, seems like it's one long anime series. Unlike most of them where they, you know, you can see the breakaparts in each episode, this one just continuously just progresses through each episode, and that's one of the reasons why the show is actually good, because it left you off in cliffhangers in places that happened to be not.
Yeah, you don't expect it. Like, you get pretty much two stories in every episode, which is very rare to see in an anime where they're, like some animes we've been watching, Jana, barely can get through one story arc in eight episodes. But this one, I think it was perfectly paced, likable characters, you know? Totally unexpected. I expected this just to be a throwaway anime, but I thought it was silly, so let's get it. But it turned out to be one of my, like I said, my favorite of the three that we've seen this week. And, you know, when we left off, we thought that Kuro was the antagonist. Look at that, Deedo. I used a big word.
Ooh, good for you.
In this story arc, but it turns out it's not. She just happens to be the hair version of the Cookie Monster.
Yes. I'm not going to sing it.
Hair is for H is for hair, and hair is for me. Okay, that didn't work.
Hair is good enough for me.
That didn't work for me, but yeah.
No, it didn't, but as they're like explaining, as she's trying to explain why that she was accepting hair like that, it's because she uses hair to regenerate her powers. And to me, I was like, that was okay and everything, but just randomly, panty shot. I mean, it had no rhyme or reason for this at all.
Panty shot one!
It was like, damn. It's like, panty shot one, mind you. And I just like, damn you, Moe fans. Damn you, Moe fans. Putting that in there randomly.
But yeah, we should make that into a drinking game. I would be severely, severely drunk after watching all of C3.
No, you're watching Ketosin.
Yeah, that's true. Or in my case, you want to see really ugly characters, you watch Air Master and do that.
Or the Chuck Norris cartoon. Every time he takes a roundhouse kick and Dude. Or knocks a villain on the ground, take a shot.
There's a Chuck Norris cartoon?
Yes, there is.
I didn't even
know. I am
know.
Not joking about this.
I did not even... Dude! Let's do that to replace C3.
It's only... I think it's like only six episodes. It was a small, I have to look it up again, but there literally, I'm not joking, there really is a Chuck Norris cartoon that is very similar to Johnny Quest in terms of style and animation.
Oh my god, I want to see it.
What were you talking? I'll link you later, I'll link you later.
What were we talking about? Oh yeah, C3. This is what Chuck Norris does to you guys, you forget what's going on. But so yeah, so while they were clearing out all that, all the shenanigans between Kuro and everything, guess what? Spider person appears. Dun dun dun! Is it Spider Monkey?
Alice. No, it's Alice. Sadly, I was all expecting. Once it's like they look over, you see just the hair fall down. I'm like going, Spider Monkey, and then all of a sudden it's Alice. I'm like, oh.
I'm like, what is, I've noticed, what is with this show and hanging upside down? That's like the preferred way to break into, what's his name? Haruki's house is to Spider-Man it in.
Spider-Monkey, doing everything, monkey is spider. Yeah, I botched it.
But yeah, like I swear that's what they do, and of course we do the classic diversion tactic by she running off, so Sword Girl, Kono, and Fear run off after her, leaving SMM Girl, and wow, I can't remember anybody's names these days, and Haruki alone in the house.
Alone.
And what happens? She's behind him and takes a hostage.
You know, the worst thing is, too, I actually put her name in here and you deleted it.
I didn't delete anything. It deleted itself. I never delete anything you write, Deedo. Except
and
for
you did. You deleted most of my notes.
I did not delete any of your notes. Blame the Google Doc. Remember last time it just randomly deleted notes? I think it's doing that again.
Blast you, Google Docs. Blast you.
Careful, the search engine gods are going to come against us and delist us, and nobody will ever be able to find us, Deedo. It was nice knowing you guys. I'm going to get deleted from the cloud now. But, yeah, I don't know who in the world takes hostages. But there's something about this anime that I don't get either, because all their electronics, they decided to go retro with this. Because after, whatever her lady takes them hostage, she uses like an old school video camera.
Yes, it's like tape old school. You know, we're talking about like KT's old camera retro.
Yeah, like the big ones that you see. With the back. And I'm like, what? And they send a tape to that, you know, doing the ransom and whatnot. And we have a lovely moment while they're captured inside a storage crate.
Or something.
Yeah, like, you know those large things they put on semi-trucks? Those large storage crate things? That's pretty much what they got locked into.
And yeah. But there's just one thing I want to say too about just before like the whole story transpires, Fear pulls out her new weapon. It's where they have to. She has at least probably like up to 30 different weapons she can create. And this whole episode, I have to say, it's very fan based. Like what you said about the panty shots, moe based, because she has a freaking cat claw.
Yeah.
Pike. I don't know what to call the thing. It was just a cursed cat claw.
I know.
Is what she actually calls it.
And you know what it looks like to me? It looks like the paw off like one of the Voltron lions, or just like the or Go Line if you're one of those hardcore animators. It's like torso combine head, and I'll form the head. Go Voltron Force.
It's so true.
That's seriously what I was thinking when I was watching that. I'm like, oh my god.
That's what makes this anime so funny and so great, because it's like all this subtle reference to a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I love it. And then, so while they're in the shipping container right there, they're handcuffed. So Haruki has his hands behind his back. And for some odd reason, what's the girl's name? Kirika. She her hands are in front. Makes no sense, because for some odd reason, the lady made everybody handcuff themselves. And so
I couldn't figure that out why either.
Yeah.
Handcuff yourself. Really?
She's lazy. Lazy, lazy, lazy. Kind of like us.
Ha. Yes, because we're professionals.
Yep. But so after that, they're stuck in the shipping container. Kirika falls over. Her skirt gets caught in one of the seams of the shipping container. Thank you, D-Max. Haruki's like, here, help. I'll help you with that, you know? And he turns around and goes, bing, you know, pulls it out. She flies over, and she's like, you flipped my skirt when you did that. And Deedo, what are we at for the panty shot count?
We're at number 2 now. Mind you, we're only still in the episode 11.
Yeah, we're only halfway through the episode right now. And
yeah, and we've already had 2 panty shots.
Yes, and Kirika and Haruki just end up having a lover's squabble. And Kuro's right there, too. And she's like, and they're both of them blushing. And Kuro's going like, oh, look, the lovers are blushing. And they're like, we're not lovers, even though they're fighting like an old married couple.
Well, it's also because Kirine is, I swear, is like a grandmother. It's like your stereotypical, like, grandmother.
Oh,
she really is.
I think she's stereotypical old people altogether.
Yeah. You're right.
And then all of a sudden, we see this invisible guy come and show up at the door of the shipping container. And he's like, I'll save you, because I'm Tuxedo Mask. Or that's what I thought when I saw him.
A really ugly mask, mind you.
Yes. And it turns out to be the Kirika's partner from the science academy that she used to be part of. Which I thought she quit like 4 episodes ago, but not.
No, somehow she's still a part of this, and therefore he comes to save Kirika, and only Kirika.
And he's like, sorry, I only can make another person invisible, and you think he'd have some cool thing to knock her out or something? No, he just uses a taser.
Yeah, when in doubt, taser somebody. Out.
Yep, and then he just carries her away and's like, I hope you guys don't think I'm a jerk. And just walks away. And the thing is, they add this random scene where you see the crazy lady just sitting next to the fireplace with a glass of wine, and you just see them walking by invisible. I'm like, what was the point of putting that in the anime at all?
I think it was mostly just to say, hey, look, they really do not actually have a presence with this mask on. I don't know. I think that's the only reason why I can see them putting that in there, is just to prove the point.
And you want to know why I'm complaining about this? Because the next scene, Kirika wakes up in a car, and then tell him what she does.
What part? Just attacking him?
Yeah, she just totally grabs the steering wheel. He crashes the car. And she walks away. I'm like, wow, that's... Talk about disposable character right there.
He did hit the airbag, so therefore he had potential to live.
But, like, seriously, they don't really talk about him at all. They kind of allude to this mystery in the sovereignty arc, but they never go into it. And then they just get rid of him in this episode. He appears conveniently, and they just get rid of him right after. I thought that was hilarious.
Of all the ways to get rid of a character, it's pretty funny just to buy a car crash. You know, and the character just kind of goes, ugh, takes the wheel, and they just spin out of control. I mean, like, you know, there is such a thing called a brake. You know, when someone does that, you just hit the brake.
Yeah. He probably would have gotten a thrill if she touched her his leg anyways.
Yeah, he has this, well, he's this big crushing character anyway, so therefore.
Yeah. And then right when she's walking away, you know, she does the tough guys don't look at explosions walk away. And she's like, I love Haruki. Yeah,
she's so pulled a diehard there. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Seriously, there's a burning car behind you and she just walks away. I love Haruki. And then walks off into the darkness. Random, I know. And I think that's actually finally the end of that episode. Right? Am I missing anything?
Yeah. That's about where it ends off on this one. So now we're on our 12th and final episode for C3.
No, don't say so. Don't say it's the final episode.
But as we see in this beginning of the 12th episode is that somehow he's out of the shipping container now. And now...
Well, no, remember the once Kirika gets back, she goes and finds Kono and Fear at the house, because everybody's always at the house.
Yeah, that house. That house.
That house, yeah. They're at that house and they get the ransom tape and they all go to that location for the final showdown.
Yes, dun, dun, dun. But here's the thing that really kind of got me is that after Haruki finds out that, you know, he is kind of the weakest link, you know, their
humor.
Yeah, exactly. So of all the things he can possibly do is that he kind of wiggles himself and everything. He sees some blood come off and everything, and then he pulls his hands out of the cuffs. I'm going, okay, I can see how your wrist could bleed from like trying to get it out, but then it's just kind of zoop, like soap.
Yep.
So,
oh yeah, we should mention like this whole time Kuro is just stuck like this, even though her head like randomly moves depending on how they put her down on the ground. Did you notice that?
Yeah, her head's always one direction or another.
I don't know, but she's supposed to be fully paralyzed, but you'll see her head's just at the right angle to have a conversation with someone.
Yeah, just strategically placed.
Okay, we'll go with that.
Yeah, so now that after Haruki is safe with the other girls, Fear pulls out her big drill of doom. We learn that the cursed items that Alice has, one is a mirror that can reflect one's personality and make clones.
Star Wars, baby. That's how the clone troopers are made.
Star Wars clones the mirror. But the thing is that what really gets me is we learn about what the Wasp is, you know, what the like all the what the families are. Especially the one that she's from is the Vero family. Their whole purpose is just to abide by the cursed items. If a cursed item wants to kill something, they appease it. If they want to drink their blood, they appease it. They do everything the cursed item wants, which is kind of creepy too, because one jumps right in front of her
Fear when she has the man grinder.
Fear's drill of doom, and Fear just completely impales her right in the stomach, and she's just kind of like, more, more, more. I'm just sitting there going, okay, drill in the stomach, kind of creepy.
Yeah, and then you see Fear, the seams start kind of going apart, because like even when she's saying more, 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 she's like, if you come join us, we can... find you an enemy or a friend or somebody that will do, you know, will do this for you too. And like that, I think that's her strong, the enemy, that lady's strong point is to break down all the enemies, because you see that happening and then you see Kono, her glasses start cracking and she's going all insane, like everybody's like emotionally breaking down during this fight. And, like, what happens in one scene is when Kirika attacks her, one of the clones, like, grabs her by the neck and holds her up, and they see this cut, and it's starting to heal slowly, but then she reaches her hand inside the cut and then starts squeezing organs. I'm like, oh!
You would assume, like, after you see that bondage snake breaking every part of her bones, and all this stuff, she wouldn't feel like an organ grab wouldn't feel that painful. But just looking at that, just going, oh.
Yeah, and let's not forget we had two panty shots in the last episode.
Yes.
And then it goes to this.
Yeah, here we go from a lighthearted humor comedy everything, and we go back to our dark side. Oh, like there's no transition, it's just kind of like night and day.
Yeah, it, oh man. And like this is actually a pretty epic fight. You know, it looks like our heroes are they're down for the count. And I don't know why they did this. All of a sudden, everything goes dark. And a spotlight comes up, and lo and behold, Deedo, tell him what happens.
Lo and behold, enter Shirino and the King of Dolls.
But you gotta tell him about the whole like Sailor Moon sequence.
She gives a whole Sailor Moon speech. I'm not joking. A whole Sailor Moon
flying,
speech.
Like it has like flying winds and whatever.
Yeah. The back. And all of a sudden, it's just like, oh, by the way, my doll will now beat you. And it's like, what, almost a 20-second gap in there? Just kind of like dead silence.
Yeah, just her trying to climb up.
And this comes up to the next most anticlimactical thing that they did in C3, which I found to be hilarious, is that you would figure, okay, with that they would do something along like they'll maybe her mass amount of fortune or something like that, like they'll have like helicopters come bombing him or something like that. Nope. What they did is just picked up Kirino and threw at the mirror.
Yeah.
Done.
That's a way to break a mirror, right? And then lo and behold, Kuro's not even she's no longer paralyzed, so she can move.
Paralyzed.
And then she does the hair thing. Octopus tentacle-like hair. Grabs all the clones.
Yes, and this is about where the game master decided to leave. And because we're talking about random hentai things. And here we go, you know. Here's Kirino with tentacle hair. Grabbing every single clone Alice and holding him up. Because she can only maintain that mirror image for 5 minutes.
10 minutes.
No, 10 minutes, sorry.
And then she's like, I'll hold the clones. You guys go take care of the original. And then we just see the kind of pretty much everybody's signature move type thing, would you say?
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. But Fear decides to actually show the ultimate technique that she's been apparently hiding for all this time.
And it's the, what is it? It's the... something Mary
it was,
man
it was
poker
such a
thing.
Freaking long title I didn't bother even writing it down. I'm like, and I'm done.
But like it's crazy, it's a statue of Mary and then all of a sudden it shoots out these like arms that grab you and then it pulls you in and then all of a sudden the face of Mary turns into like this vicious like raptor teeth looking like thing and is coming at you. And that's not the whole ear of it, it's like a whole box. And then you see these spikes pop out the side of the walls, and then the box closes in on a person. Right when I saw that, I'm like, there's no way anybody can survive that. There's no way.
But here we are, next scene. She just looks like she's been battered up a little, you know?
Yeah. Broken glasses, and she got da 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 da.
Yeah, I found that the weirdest way to end a fight.
Yeah, and I don't know how this works, but she's right at the edge of the pier. Or wherever the shipping dock or whatever at. And which doesn't make any sense since they were fighting the other direction. And somehow she ends up on that part. And we see her backing. Yep. We just see her backing up to the ledge. And I'm like, oh, she's going to kill herself. And then Fear's going to have to go through this whole crazy, you know, self-redeeming, I kill the person type thing. And then she jumps off. I'm like, oh, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And then all of a sudden, a speedboat comes in, and then this guy just catches her in the nick of time, and he's like, "Hey, honey, how you?" like kind of like the Ken character from the Barbie dolls, you know? It's like, "Hey, honey,
yeah,
how
pretty
you
much,
except with a cigar." And they like fly off, and then It was, wasn't it Kiriko? And Fear's like, not so fast, and they throw this long-range weapon at them, and then all of a sudden, like, the guy turns into a wasp and, like, deflects all of them and lands. He's like a giant anchor, too. And then this is where it disturbed me a little bit, was the lady just, like, almost, like, dry humps the wasp in its wasp form.
Yeah, and he's just, like, going, yeah, baby. And then turns back, and he's completely naked. Which is the funniest thing, too. He's just completely naked, and it's like the most, his bits and everything are just barely covered up by her knee.
Yeah. And, you know, they go through this long thing, like, oh, you're from the Science Academy, and blah, blah, blah. Look at all those wasps together, da, 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 da. I guess we'll retreat for now. But be warned, Captain Gadget, I'm after you.
Yeah.
And they essentially, after that, ride into the sunset.
Yeah, so at this point, I'm going, this is how they're ending the season? This is how they're ending C3? Really?
Yeah. Well, they have to have another season. There's still a lot of open-ended things, even though they kind of tried to close them all at the like super last scene. But before we get to that, you remember that scene from scene 5? Or episode 5? You guys know what I'm talking about. You guys know what I'm talking about.
For those people who don't know, who actually haven't followed us all the way and just kind of popping in right now, don't know about episode 5 when Haruki kind of inserts the disc
thing into the thing.
Yeah. It had a really provocative scene. Yeah.
And this time it just happened that Kuro does the Tenchi's dad style thing and has a camera.
Yes. Oh, that was a funny scene. And as they're trying to explain this too, we see panty shot number 3 when Haruki lays down on there while the rest of the other 3 are practicing their dance, which happens to be the dance from the first opener of C3. And Kuro's just kind of standing over Haruki and he just looks up and boom, panty shots. Like,
yep.
You just wanted to show that to him, didn't you?
Yeah, and he turns all red and goes, and then that's when we find out about the disc insertion, the maintenance.
Yes, why maintenance is important, everybody. Yes.
And then all of a sudden, you know, they're still trying to teach Fear how to do the dance and whatnot. And what's her name? Kiriko. She takes off her clothes and like, what? And it's like, well, it's hot outside. And she's just in her bondage gear. I'm like, oh man.
Yeah, I'm like they try to put as much fan service as possible in these last 2 episodes. It was absolutely hilarious.
And then, of course, for some reason, Kuro just pulls out her Ganon HD video camera again and is filming it. I'm like, seriously? Just out of random.
Yes, Kuro's a dirty old man. I'm sorry. Kirine like, is just a dirty old man.
She's like the combination I think of dirty old grandma. And, it's awesome. And that, my friends, is actually how they end C3. There has to be another season.
Yeah. I hope there's a second season of C3.
To be honest, out of all 3 series right now, I don't think I ever was disappointed in any episode. I enjoyed like all 12 episodes. It was a good run.
Yeah, for anyone who is curious about what we've been talking about for the last, you know, 6 episodes, do pick up C3. Check it out.
Yes.
And hear exactly what we mean by what we're talking about in C3. Like, it's a shame that we're going to be finished, and it's finished up now.
Yeah.
And we have to move on to the next anime.
If out of the 3 animes that we watched for the fall season, if you only can watch one, go watch C3. It's actually enjoyable. I liked it, you know? Unlike some of our other ones and some of the other ones that are trying to disappoint. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, you know? We're about to get into.
Yeah. So, speaking of disappointment, I guess we can do it. Right, Deedo?
Yeah. Enter in next anime.
Light my disappointment. Of course, our next anime is Shakugan no Shana Final, or 3, or whatever you want to call it now. And it's brought to you by Reassurance, because we thought we were only getting 12 episodes, and that disappointed us. Now we're going to have 24 disappointed episodes, all coming up.
When originally we found about the show, it was supposed to be a 12er. Then I went and looked it up again after a while, and I found out it's actually a 24 episode anime. So therefore, we must correct our last one saying it was 12.
Where did we last leave off? Seems like we haven't gone anywhere really.
Yeah. Apparently, in the last we left off for the past 8 episodes, Shana learns how to fight again. Lions can blow horns and make very big explosions.
Boom! Oh, and then the first scene they actually show in this after the theme song intro is they're on the battlefield. And remember, when they landed, the general landed and it was desert. There's snow outside. And you're like, what? Set up camp?
I had to backtrack. I literally backtracked a couple episodes, went through and skipped watched it, and I'm going, where in the world did it say it was snowing? Not one place. It's all of a sudden, bam, there's a blizzard.
Yeah, and then that goes to my next pet peeve, because we see all the armies all lined up in their formations.
Yeah.
And when they start the battle, they all just run into a straight line. And I've never understood this. Why does everybody still fight like this European style battle where you run in a straight line? It does not make logical sense at all.
I mean, I'm sure one side or another has someone with a long range, heaven forbid saying beam rifle, and just take out a big section of that. You know, I'm pretty sure there's enough flame haze to have it. Enough power to just blow one of those sections to Kingdom Come.
Yeah,
but they're just facing off, just like going, like growling at each other and just waiting to charge.
Yeah, you'd think they'd like be spread out so it's, you know, they can divide the main forces and come after you or something like that. But no, they're just like literally lined European style battle and just ready to get taken, picked off by each side. I'm like, oh man, that doesn't work anymore. Not when you can shoot fireballs out of your hands and whatnot.
Yeah, so after all this shenanigans of them talking about the battlefield and strategy, blah, 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 we see Sato again, comes back and goes to Marjorie.
Oh my God. This guy, like, has he done anything at all in the whole entire anime? He's got locked. All he's done is ride the subway, get locked in a room, ride the subway back, then go back to Marjorie's place. And like, I like how he's like, oh, I'm going to go to the Flame Haze HQ for training and all. He didn't get any training. He got locked in a room.
Matter of fact, he was a hostage. He wasn't getting locked in a room. He was just a hostage.
Yeah, he was a hostage. And, like, literally, that's all he did for this whole entire anime series. He rode the train, and then both ways, and that was pretty much it. And then got some nookie at the end.
Yeah. Of all the characters that we've mentioned so far, Marjorie's the one where I'm just kind of like, oh, wow, there's a name we haven't said in, like,
oh, she's still around? It's longer than a month. It's been, like
out of nowhere, like, oh, look, Marjorie. We're saying a name again that's... Yeah, how about that?
Man.
But I just want to mention this one. Okay, so halfway through the 11th episode, when that transition of, you know, commercials and everything, the second picture they usually put in there is always like a joke ad and everything.
Yeah.
I just saw like the head of the Flame Hazes about to Falcon punch the eel. And that made me laugh. I had to pause it and actually look at that. I was like, what the hell?
And you know what's funny? Later on in an episode, guess what happens?
Yes, it goes there. So we'll mention that. But I just like after the and see the battle, transpiring between the Flame Hazes and the Crimson Denizens. The one thing that made me laugh the hardest was that all of a sudden you see a middle-aged Mustang. A middle-aged Roy Mustang just flaming things left and right. I was laughing hardcore. Yeah. You see him a couple different times in there.
I was rooting for that fat guy.
Yeah.
do you know that fat guy? He's just like taking names everywhere. I'm like, come on, go fat Flame Haze guy. I don't even know who you are, but go on.
Yeah, he's like, go secondary Flame Haze character that's probably going to die in 20 minutes. Go! You know, because they're like, all the Flame Hazes are doing well, fighting off all the Denizen army. They're just like, they're beating left and right. You're seeing daggers getting thrown in their heads. They're all like going, ah, you know, big sword swipes and everything. Takes out like five of them. Ah, I'm like, oh, well, this doesn't seem very much. And then comes the eel.
You know that, and apparently he's been swimming under the base. I'm like, you make a horrible defense guy if all you do is swim in water when you're in the desert.
Sorry. It's like whenever I think about like this eel, this Crimson Lord eel, how he's supposed to be like apparently really, really powerful to the point where he cannot actually be outside the water and everything, so he uses like restricted spells and everything to bring himself out every so often. But all of a sudden he's like pops out of the ground and like in several different versions of himself, just, and then it's all of a sudden this just kind of is the deterrent in the battle, and then a lot of Flame Hazes start to die, start getting killed, start getting massacred by the same army that they're just beating the trash out of, and he's just kind of just chilling out there, not doing anything.
He just like stands, like you'll see like multiple heads of him, and he's just like, apparently he's doing spells on each of the dudes, so they're protected against all the spells that the Flame Hazes were using on them, and that's what apparently turns the tide of the battle. Kind of anticlimactic, actually talking about it now.
Yeah,
he's like, he puts his antennae out, and then they're unable to fight off the dudes.
Yeah, it was a very, like the whole deterrent of the battle and everything is determined by how many, three eel heads, four eel heads popping out, and it's just like, oh, by the way, no, check this out, guys, and it's like the whole battle just goes the opposite direction.
Yeah.
But we can't forget the best part too. One of the generals of the Flame Hazes builds a giant bridge. All the way to the headquarters of,
that one.
And now you're just sitting there going like, of all the things in the world, stuff, he built a bridge. He built the castle, and then just kind of built this bridge.
And that, I have to admit, that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Because he's talking to his little thing, avatar thing, and he's like, we're going to build a bridge. And he's like, all right, let's do this.
I'm sorry. Like, every single time I'm thinking about this, too, because it was just like a little while ago, so when I finished up watching Brotherhood, you know, Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood, and I just have this kind of like, that's the reason why I got that Roy Mustang reference in there, and all of a sudden I see him building a bridge, just puts his hands on the ground, build the bridge, and I'm just sitting there going, oh, Wally.
Equivalent.
Yes.
Make sure there's equivalence.
It was funny to me. It was just funny to me because like how much anime like references each other so much, it just makes me laugh. But not doesn't make me laugh as hard as what just happened. So the eel, you know, the dancing eel, decides to destroy the bridge because, you know, obviously that's a big deterrent in the battle right there. So he kind of like materializes himself into one of the heads so he can destroy the bridge and stop their advancement. But lo and behold, KT, tell us what happened.
Oh, of course, the Flame Haze, you know. All of a sudden you just hear, I see you, and then this huge giant, you know, the Flame Haze lady who's in charge, the nun, just comes in and Falcon Kick. And the funny thing is, I'm sorry to say, but I was thinking about Dragon Ball Z the whole time, because when the eel's about to do it, I'm like, he's just doing Kamehameha.
Actually, the first thing came to my head was Gurren Lagann. No, seriously, it was the most. It was like the most epic thing in the world by an old lady coming out of the sky in a thunderbolt of all things, and just completely Falcon Kicks this eel in the back of the head.
Yeah, and he just totally dematerializes out of. You can just see him. The beam misses the bridge barely, so the main forces are already through, and then like he just breaks into a million pieces. And when they land, it's like, do you think you used a little too much power? And she's like, yeah, that's worth it.
Yeah. It was so over the top. I mean, that was probably when that scene alone kind of made me go, all right, maybe this has some, maybe this can turn it around a little, you know, because over the top stuff is fun.
Yeah. And then, you know, when it looks like it's actually turning the tide for the Flame Hazes, what happens is the, was it the Western Army or was it the Eastern Army?
Yeah, the Western Army.
The Western Army just does a sneak attack that avoided all the radar tracking and everything because they were using birds or something to conceal their aura, as you might add. So the whole Western Army is over there, and then the lady's like, we've just run out of time. Dun, dun, dun. And it cuts from there to where Shauna and everybody, because at the beginning of this whole entire thing, Shauna's like, what's up, guys? Me and my homies, we're going into the God Gate. Peace. And that's literally what she did.
Yeah, that's literally it. It just kind of come in, just gives her speech like, we be going God Gate. Peace. And then it takes off.
Yeah, she
just and takes then, the, off. Then the battle just starts. Just kind of like, all right, so we're waiting for Shauna to come back. Announce that she's going to go take out the, you know, the serpent, or
Lord
the god
of darkness.
Serpent.
I don't know why this anime has
Lord Darkness such... Serpent of things.
Well, I don't understand why everybody has to have like this seven name and every time they talk, if that happened in real life, I think that'd be a little annoying.
Now they'll probably like know each other's name a lot better because they live for, you know, for as long as they do, because some of them are hundreds of thousands of years old. Anyways,
you're telling me the next episode of the Kita Anime Podcast, I should go Deedo, Le Arc of the lightsaber blocking PS3 headphone webcam world, right?
No, I will just like, okay, you know what? I'm done now. Just I'll end the podcast there.
okay. I'm telling you, just saying, it doesn't work in real life.
No, it doesn't. Me for European and having like five different names from your uncle's grandmother's middle last third removed child's name put into your name where it's like seven names long. You know that works perfectly fine because you have a history behind it. And I was like, this one, it's yeah,
yeah.
And Shauna just doesn't work very well.
But anyways. So, and then I think somewhere in between this, we get or the episode ends. And then, Deedo, this was your favorite part, and the final, but not really final, episode of Shauna.
Yeah. We come across one of the old Crimson Denizens that was from the second season that they were fighting in the end, which is the assassin. He is back. And he pops a scene from Toho and starts firing limitless amounts of fireballs. Just flying straight to him and missing. You know, you'd figure like someone who it's just showy, you know, it's like fireworks just everywhere. But, and for all those who don't know what I'm talking about by Toho, Google it. You'll find it'd be a very fun game.
Only one game, there's many games.
Yes, there are. There are many Toho games.
This is what's funny, though, about this guy is every time he's fighting, he just goes into these stories, and all of a sudden it cuts to the flame hazes, and the old man, he just takes this giant rock and drops it on him, and he's like, man, I've always heard stories about how long his stories go, and then the... Fireball chicks like, and they just keep going and going and going. And I'm like, just okay, the random thing. It's like that should shut them up for a little bit.
And then they just kind of like run away and everything. Starting to tell a little bit more story about him, and then he's coming from the ground again.
Yeah, that's actually a really interesting battle, and we find out the old man can't go into his giant mecha because. Those blades that the guy launched are everywhere, and so he can't form his armor since the blades would interfere with it somehow. I guess they're in the air or whatever.
Yeah.
But they didn't explain it that well.
He just basically said his ceremonial dress, which means his big mecha form, is there's just not enough know, clean material, so to speak, to materialize it in full form, so he couldn't actually do it. But on the other hand itself, they did able to launch Shauna past the assassin with bonded or with a bandage armor.
Bandage armor. And the old man spinning his whatever he's carrying behind him, like that white stick thing.
The tuning rod. I think it's called his tuning rod.
Yeah.
But I find it so funny that he's just kind of like melodramatic about it too. Just kind of like dispersed. And it's just like, really?
He's an old wise man.
True. But it makes me laugh because he's so like so monotone about it. You know, doesn't try to go over the top stuff like Rebecca does. You know, just so headstrong, so head forward and everything, and just completely jock type. You know, really stupid but very powerful.
And you know, Shauna just glides through with the help of one of the old flame hazes that captured the serpent dude guy before, that the god gate is opening towards. And you know, Shauna just sails through while the rest of them go into bandage armor while all the blades go everywhere.
Yeah, and the greatest thing is too, out of nowhere, they keep on talking about it, and the old man throws another rock at him, and literally fishing rod style, just woof, and just kind of like slaps him inside of the head, like, oh, by the way, gotcha.
Yeah, and he's like, this is all I can do. But yeah, and then after that, you know, they keep going on the battle, and they of course end in another cliffhanger. Why not? Because they got 24 more or 12 more episodes to go through, so don't want to rush these things, right, Deedo? We got to take our time.
Don't want to, because that's why they have now released his true form. His true form is now released. Shauna, or Alistair, gets back to Shauna, and that's about it.
Yeah. And during the end credits, Shauna and Yuji have a long
chat about their differences.
Why
they're going to fight each other. But before all that happens, we do see an exploding ball of death.
Yes, that's true. That's true. Right when they make the cliffhanger of the old man and everybody fighting, the what's her name?
Carmel.
Carmel, yeah. They're all named after food. Carmel makes a giant bandage ball. Yeah. And then Rebecca just
totally lays waste to what's inside it, which happens to be the assassin.
Yeah. Or not. It happens to be his double that the predictor lady gave to him. And he's like, I hate it when she's right. And then that's where it cuts off on there. Right? I'm not missing anything.
Yes. Well, Rebecca did get sliced in the back.
Oh, yes. He slices Rebecca in the back and is like, I hate it when she's right. And then he looks at the old man, one more to go. Because apparently, however he's slicing them, they can't heal themselves. Because Carmel was like trying all the spells she knows and nothing has been working.
Well, one was working until he cut it.
Yeah.
And it didn't work very well after that.
Yeah. Overall, these 12 episodes have been not my favorite. They've been dragging and disappointing.
Well, for a Shauna series, this is kind of what I expect from a Shauna series, but from the last, you know, the final season itself, I was expecting a little bit more
upbeat,
you know, they're like, because the second season is mostly like, you know, school comedy.
That kind of follows the Full Metal Panic thing, where they were all serious the first season, and then they got Fumumfu, and then they went back to the second raid type thing, you know? I'd go for that, but
you know, that's how they had the story set. And this one, that's just like, they almost feel like they're trying to wrap it up too quick, but at the same time, too, they have a full season to do it.
And they're taking their sweet time, because like we said, that was like, you'll start looking at your watch when Yuji and Shauna are talking to each other. I'm like, are they done yet?
I will only give this much too. I mean, if it wasn't for like the ending credits of Shauna are good.
Yes.
You know, it has that whole Move feel, because for anyone who knows Move, you know, they did a lot of Initial D music and everything, but there's always like the female singer and then a guy always talking, rapping in the background too, keeping it within rhythm. So, you know, if it wasn't for like their ending theme by Ultima, it would probably have not been that interesting. You know,
yeah.
That's probably one of the good things about Shauna, is they always chose some pretty interesting music to go with this seasons and all the shows. So.
Yeah. I'm hoping to actually see Shauna fight.
Well, I'm thinking like they lead the first 12 episodes up for everybody, because it seems like Sato might actually fight now, because he's now with Marjorie. And
you kidding me? He's going to get locked in another room.
Look, wishful thinking. I'm trying to give Shauna a chance here. I mean, you know, it's one of my favorite shows when I first heard about it back in like 2002, 2004.
Yeah, and now what it is, it's the third in the lists of the three that we've watched. Unfortunately.
Yeah.
I want it to be good. That's the thing. I really want it to be a good series, but it's kind of disappointing.
I think that's my problem, is that I left it to where I was expecting a lot, and now I'm kind of like going, I try not to like hype things up too much, because I can only, at least then I can only expect what I'm expecting, and I'm still kind of on the edge of, I'm still kind of offensive really about this show, but I'm still enjoying it for what it is, needless to say.
But guess what, Deedo? That's all we got.
Yeah.
We're like at an hour and 10
minutes.
But,
ladies and gentlemen, hour and 10 minutes is probably one of the shorter episodes of Kita you have seen today.
Yeah.
But we are going to be filling C3 with a new anime. For those who didn't tell us, because no one has emailed us about anime, we're going to be doing another show called Anta no Natsu de Matsuru, which is done by the same people who did Onegai Teacher and Onegai Twins.
Yes.
So for all those who, we're big fans of this series too. And it should be airing out on the 12th. So hopefully we'll see some of our favorite fan subbers do this, and we will probably have at least the first episode to do with the three episodes of Guilty Crown on next Kita.
Yeah, you guys are gonna love it. But until then, guess where I'm going next week, Deedo? If you guys didn't hear the ad at the beginning, I'm going to Vegas, baby, for CES 2012. So like the ad said, keep an eye on Twitter and keep an eye on the website, because I'll be posting stuff, and we'll see how well the Wi-Fi is in my room. I might even try to stream a little bit over there sometime at night. Deedo, you got another BlackRock shooter figure that you're showing off on the site too, right?
Yes. As for those who have seen my review on BlackRock Shooter the game, I did get the Figma for BlackRock Shooter. It is now on the site and the review at ktdata.com. And I have some fun with that too. I'm hoping to see that. What was that?
Nothing. Just keep going. KitaData.com. I need to go register that now.
KitaData. Sorry, KT Data. Thank you, KT, for fixing my mistakes again. Just like I couldn't spell reassurance, because I spelled it reinsurance instead of reassurance.
I was reading that earlier today. I'm like, what are we reinsuring, and are we using Geico, or what? What is he trying to say here?
Yes, I did spell it correctly. I just had the wrong meaning. I'm thinking reinsurance, but it's reassurance. English. I know it.
Maybe.
I think. I don't know English. I know American. For anyone who wants to know more about the series, because I don't know, we haven't really got much info about the Anta no Natsu de Matsuru show, you can check it out on animenewsnetwork.com. There isn't any extra information on it up right now, but I'm highly anticipating it because it's by a creator that we have been following for a while, too.
Yeah, so hopefully I'm going to go try and find a trailer somewhere so we can put that in the show notes. Of course, the show notes are at ktdata.net. You guys really should watch the video episode. Like, we do crazy things that sometimes we don't mention on the audio podcast, so you're missing out. But it's still cool if you're listening audio-wise, you know? Either way, but, you know, to get the complete package. The video one's probably a little bit better. Watching us live actually will get you the super complete package. You know those collector's editions that you can get in stores when you buy DVDs? That would be the live stream right there. Yeah, of course, we do it every 2 weeks. So next broadcast is actually January 17th when we do it live. So make sure you guys come over. It's ktdata.net/live. And that will be 7 p.m.-ish, depending on when KT actually finishes watching the animes.
Or if I ever have to go to the bathroom again.
Yeah.
Just before the show starts.
Yes. But for everybody watching, this is the last episode of Kita for the fall season. So the next episode you'll see after this will say winter 2011 or 2012 on it. Or, yeah, winter.
Yes. We are now in the new year, KT.
Yes.
Believe that or not.
Yes. So you'll see that. And, you know, like I said, thank you. Tell your friends. If you know your friends who like anime, we're kind of like the mystery science theater. Well, we're the commentary that you should listen to along with the episodes. Especially, you know, if you don't have a lot of friends who watch anime, you can be our friends and just play us along while you're watching. Send us feedback at kita@ktdata.net. You know, we will respond to them. I have an awesome mail drop that's just sitting there that I really want to play really, really bad too. So email us something. Hate mail. I'll read hate mail at this point. You send us a sponsor ad. Whatever it says, as long as it's clean, I will read it on air for one of the shows. So yeah, thank you all. Deedo, always. It is always a blast to do this with you. And just to geek out about anime and all the other crazy shenanigans that we do all the time. Because
this is all by ear. None of this is ever scripted. We do this all by ear.
Oh, we practice these for hours a day. Don't let Deedo lie to you. It's a secret. But yeah, so... yeah, that's all we got now, guys. We will see you guys in 2 weeks. Like I said, keep an eye on CES. I'll have some videos out for this week too. I'm gonna get those done before I go to CES. And till next time, guys, bye.
Ah, and there we have it.
That's going. Everything's recording. We're going like this.